letzten Talk in der Wikipacker-WG. Es geht um das Thema Urheberrecht. Das hat ja dieses Jahr doch recht viele Leute bewegt mit der Urheberrechtsreform der EU. Und John hält jetzt einen Vortrag darüber zum Thema Grundlagen, Urheberrecht, Schwerpunkt,
Creative This is John's talk about Creative Commons, copyright licenses. I'm not going to say much more and wish you a pleasant talk. This is the translation of Felix Vidi, Moritz S. Zed, and Icon Eye. Please feel free to give us comments on c3lingo.org and at the hashtag C3T.
Nanu?
Ah ja. So.
Ja, herzlich willkommen. Ich werde allerdings.
Welcome to everyone.
Über die EU-Urheberrechtsreform sprechen.
I will not be talking about the EU copyright reform, and I can't really hear it anymore. I would like to talk to you about copyright, mostly about images and how you can use Creative Commons licenses. I need to be quick because I will only have 15 minutes and some Q&A, and it's quite ambitious. So, I have two parts. First, copyright as seen by photographers, and the second part, Creative Commons licenses in practice. Everyone seems to have heard about it before. Today we will be talking about these two things up there, copyright and closely related rights, basics of copyrights as seen by photographers. We'll be talking about the copyright of the motif that you're taking a photo of, and of the photo that you took. First, the rights of photographed objects. What can I photograph without asking? When do I have to ask specifically for permission? And then who do I ask for this permission? So, what can I do, what can I take a photo of without asking? Not everything that we can take a photo of is subject to copyright. For example, this is the famous ape selfie, the monkey, the ape that has taken a picture of himself. He is not able to hold a copyright, so the animals can take photos of themselves as much as they like and they cannot sue me for the copyright. And I can obviously take photos of landscapes and not be subject to copyright on that image, as long as there's no one seen in the image. We need to fix this little thing, live. There we go. But here we start with the small print already, as you can see. Since what's going on?
Komisch.
Strange. We lost my preview, but we'll manage. There we are. I can take pictures of the landscape as long as there's no people or recognizable works. And in Germany, I can still take pictures regardless of who owns this landscape or the objects. But that might change in the future. We'll get to this later. Now it's getting a bit slower. Old and works in the public domain can be freely photographed as your own work. You can also take a picture of this old piece of art of the Notre Dame. However, everything beyond that is complicated. It gets more complicated. Lots of things can be protected by copyright. It needs only three things. It needs just one person to bring something new in a perceptible form. For example, this house. You would think it is not something particularly complicated to do. However, Usually the architect has a copyright on this concept of a house. Another thing that has recently become a problem is logos and trademarks. Usually, or in the past, it has not been a problem. However, by now, courts have decided that even using logos, you need to be considering the copyright. This is a rough overview of the types of works that exist. This is not comprehensive. There might be types of works that no one has thought of before. And all of those are also, from the start, covered by the copyright law in Germany, and that is good. Apart from that, there is something called the German Leistungsschutzrechte. These are related rights to copyrights, and they relate to the usage of words. These lie with the companies that support services or provide services related to the exploitation of this work. For example, production companies, record companies, or publishers are parts of works able to be copyrighted. Yes, as long as the particular part is sufficiently individual, and usually it is. For example, if the first photo on the left side is copyrighted, then the picture on the right-hand side is also copyrighted. So you cannot evade copyright in this way. What does copyright mean? It means all rights are protected. Everything that you can have as copyright, as a right, is protected by the copyright. And everything I'm talking about now is immediately copyrighted, is immediately covered by copyright. Everything quite simple and nice to the creators of the work. But naturally, creators need to cover the public.
Mit lauter architektonischen Werken auseinandersetzen. Das heißt, wenn ich als Urheber mein Werk in
creators need to respect the needs of the common domain, the public. So, whoever releases works into the public domain or who exposes them to the public needs to be aware that some of these rights might be infringed or might need to be limited. So, all the works that are, for example, exposed or shown in public, they need to be seen or need to be able to be seen by the public. For example, and that's why these limits to copyright exist.
There's a very important right to cite. There's a law that says that you can talk about other people's works in your own works. But that only means that you can talk about it but not copy somebody else's work. It's about covering the contents of another works. But it's supposed to be limited to only the amount of work you need. There's another work. For example, on this Congress, if you're able to protect certain parts. For example, you're able to take pictures of certain things put up at the Congress. But the courts changed the laws to be more strict. So there's a law that says that it only counts if it doesn't have a certain relation to the main thing. And it's a very problematic law, because when you look at Congress, you could say that each work is part of the entire image.
Sandro, hilf mir mal, wie heißt das? Konzerthaus. Das Konzerthaus in Berlin?
For example, there's a concert hall in Berlin.
Hallo?
Hold on. Right. So, the concert house in Berlin. It's a very old building, so the creator is already dead. So but these works on the walls are newer works, so there's the question if the previous rule applies to it or not. Because it's still important for the work, so the new law makes it more difficult to judge that. So there's an there's important law about daily events, but that's only restricted to people who are doing, who are talking about daily events, like blogs and media, like TV. But the restriction is that it still needs to be a new, actual, up-to-date thing. A few days after, it's still okay, but weeks or months after that, it gets more difficult. You can't just cover it easily. And that's made more difficult by the internet because posts stay up on the internet for multiple months. So it's limited by time. There's another law called panoramic freedom.
Deutschland darf ich nur vom Straßenniveau aus Bilder von Gebäuden machen. Die Panoramafreiheit erlaubt mir alle.
So in Germany you're able to take pictures from the street level. So you're able to cover multiple works like statues and plastics when you're taking pictures of them from the public street areas. But just from the street level, you can't climb up with a ladder or hold up a selfie stick. It's just for the range a human can reach with a camera. For example, taking a picture of the 100 Wasserhaus. In Austria, it's different. You can take pictures from the first level as well, but you can't do that in Germany. There's a quiz question now. The federal court in Berlin doesn't count as a panoramic view, but that law doesn't apply since it's the inner space, not the outer space. So, has anyone been alive when the government was put covered? So, does it count as panoramic freedom? No, it doesn't, since it needs to be a permanent thing that's applied, but the covered government was only there for 2 weeks, so it doesn't count as permanent, so it doesn't fall under that law. That's why you can't see it on Wikipedia when you look it up. Wikipedia is always very conform to the rights, so it's not even linked there. So what he's doing currently is only half legal, because normally I can't show it to you, because it's a temporary work. Now what about the mouth from the AIDA ships? You can certainly argue about that. Is it something that's permanently applied, since ships move? But courts say that it's permanently there. It might move, but it's still always publicly available. Another example is ads on buses. You're able to take photos of them even though it's moving, because it's in public space, permanently viewable. Not to forget, that's something they like to forget. You still need to mention architects and artists of the works portrayed. I just wanted to mention that. so works from official works. You still need to mention sources, but you can't change it.
So, when you talk about the Open Knowledge Foundation, about the topic of official work pieces, then they always tend to get scared at that thing, because you can't take a part of that out of these official documents. It has to be the entire document. Open data doesn't work that way, and that's difficult. And so we at Wikimedia Germany try and have this changed. These are the restrictions. Now, sometimes there is no governed allowing to take this photo. If what I do reaches an official audience or a public audience, the way in that it does, in which it does this, is entirely not important. There's a definition within that public is everything with that public, as everything that isn't directly connected to me counts as public. If you all were my my ex-colleagues or my previous school buddies, then this wouldn't be a public event, because then we would be a closed thing. This doesn't have to be a big number of people. A big family party can still be not public, but in this instance, these four people would also be a public instance. So justification is whenever you do a small party and you want to stay in public rooms, then you would have to bring people who are not closely related to you. So something that doesn't have a password in the internet is always a public scene. But the EUGH doesn't view it as critical. When you download copies from a third server, because that's not a public source, then that isn't considered public, as it is more difficult to do this in the web. If something goes wrong, who is responsible? Basically, everyone who is with this. Everything always is governed in favor of the publisher. He or she can go towards everyone who took part. So, in the instance of this picture, the one who took this picture is really the one who is liable. The ones who distributed it aren't really responsible, because if not for this one person, it wouldn't have been published. Well, who is the sourcer? Who is the one who did this? Companies can't really be creators. Companies can only be the ones holding the copyright for this. So it has to be a human person who is the creator. It has to be the person who actually took this photo. Sometimes, though, it's a bit more difficult. These are some examples. These are all creators, so like componists, sculpturists, and choreographers. They are all creators. There are more kinds of creators, but these are just some examples. You do not have to register anywhere. You do not have to. You do not have to state copyright anywhere. If multiple people had the rights to this picture, then 70 years after the last person of this group died, the copyrights apply. Whenever this runs out, this copyright law runs out, it can be used by everyone and by the public. This is very similar with related rights and copyrights. What gets left out mostly is copyrights in music and copyrights in classical music. The work itself is openly available, but recordings of the work itself are mostly not publicly available. These old music, you can't really just link old music or use old music in that way, because you always have to think about not the ones who wrote the music, but the ones who composed it. No, the other way around. Well, you always have to think who is a creator and who is a secondary creator. It's determined by saying who actually contributed to the project. You actually have to act in this sort of project, and you actually have to be in there in the process. You don't have to have an idea. Just has to be in there. When it's so intertwined that you can't really distinguish it, it's not really copyrights. There was a law case in this where someone drew this picture of a mouse and someone altered it a bit. He just basically changed the mouse's legs and nose, and the law said to that that only the one who originally drew the mouse is the copyright holder. That's also the case with movies. It's mostly shared copyright holdership, as there's many people during this process. So everyone would be a shared copyright holder who participated in any way. Maybe there's producers and actors and people who did the lighting, and only if the last of those persons died, then the 70-year period of copyright holdership starts. That happens whenever anything is copyright claimed. This also means that, especially with movies, copyrights can only be given to people by the entirety of the shareholders. It has to be a unanimous decision in that way. There's also the right to the own picture. This is the Sanssouci case. Someone made pictures of the Castle Sanssouci in Potsdam, and then the non-profit or the organization whom this castle belonged to claimed copyrights over this house, and this one court decided that indeed they can do that, as they actually although they aren't invested in this picture, they are invested in this castle, and out of this role of ownership they can demand the stopping of these pictures. It doesn't really matter who the things in the picture belong to. It's not really important most of the time, but I hope it stays this way, because if you would justice it this way, you couldn't really take any pictures anymore without always being unlawful in some way. So this case is just some sort of exception to this rule or special thing. I hope this is not the future. I do really hope that ownership doesn't really matter.
So what about my own pictures? In this case it's the same thing, just the other way around. When am I with concluding with others? When do I sit in the same boat? If the picture is an artistically valuable picture or a work of art, then at least I always have the right to that picture. For example, if I took a picture of all of you, then I would have the right to that picture. I won't do that. So to start with, all the rights lie with me, which is great. I can be happy. In theory, that couldn't have been shown, but oh, whatever. What can I do? If I have the copyright, I can give the license to give you and you and you the right to reproduce that work, or to give it out under standard license, such as Creative Commons licenses, CC licenses. I can reproduce the picture myself, work on it, change it, destroy it, or do nothing at all. However, if other people infringe on my rights, then I can call them to court. I can call them to my rights. I can sue them so that they stop using or reproducing my works. I can sue them for compensation of damages. I can alert the police, since that is technically a crime, although in practice it doesn't really have any relevance, and unless it's really commercial piracy. It used to be DVDs, large-scale copying, that sort of thing would be pursued by the police, but usually it would not be. And also I can just leave all of that be and do nothing. So I have the right to first publication. And I also have the right, inalienable, to be named as the creator of that right. I also have the right to refuse to be or to not be named as the creator of the work. And I also have the protection of extreme modification of deformation of the work. So if my work of art, if my piece is changed to an extreme degree that infringes upon my rights. In Japan, you can basically not change the work at all. In Germany, the limitations are a little bit more flexible. That is generally everything that I can do in terms of civil rights as the creator in Germany. And I also have all the rights to monetization of my work. I can reproduce my work, I can publish it, I can show it publicly in all sorts of ways. Those are all my rights. So, my legal position is excellent. So, when am I sitting with everyone else, my other co-creators, in one boat? That is the case when others have, as said before, worked together with me or contributed to the creation of the photos. With photos, it's a little bit more difficult to reproduce or to retrace. However, that is usually the case when it's a very constructed photo with lots of lighting, lots of organized imagery and settings of frames. It is also the case if I take pictures of the works of others, since that is part of the picture and I couldn't have created the picture without that. That is the same sort of constellation, then we have to decide together.
Dazu später mehr, war heute Mittag schon, also das kommt jetzt nicht mehr.
This part has already been talked about this noon, so I won't go into this anymore. If I photograph people who are recognizable, then I need their permission too to reproduce the picture. What else? We'll get to this later. Wikimedia Commons is a big media archive from which all of the pictures used in Wikipedia are used. People upload pictures to Wikimedia and wait for them to be used in Wikipedia. Some of these are uploaded with the intention that people accidentally use them and then can be billed for it. There's no real solution to this yet. It happens once in a while. There's a few hundred of these cases, and we're working to make that work better.
So now we're covering part two, CC licenses as tools. So these licenses are special since they allow it to multiple people at once. That's not restricted to Wikimedia projects. So something I want to repeat, what is open content, what are Creative Commons, what are modules and what tools are there to use? So what is open content? There's a definition from the 90s. The material is open if it's allowed to be used, studied, multiplied without special permission. That might sound a little strange. It's from the area of free software. So part two, studying it is a little useless since you can take a look at pictures anyways. But it has been taken into account since most of the time you can't take a look at code easily since it's compiled. That just started when companies started to keep the code to themselves. So that's why number two, studying the work, is amended. So that's wonderful. So when all of these apply, it's open content. And that's especially tricky. So me, as someone who doesn't have any experience, has to be able to use it. So that's where the problem lies. So there's a special case with time and aerial restrictions, since, for example, with movies, there are different rights regarding which country you watch a movie in. So with these rules, normal people who don't know about laws struggle to work with that. For example, if you need to calculate how long you're able to use a work. So that's what practically and without any risk means. So that's why it's a special thing. It's not about very specific license contracts. It's about applying it to the masses, to everybody, without special knowledge needed beforehand. So there's something, the open definition from the Open Knowledge Foundation. It has a similar definition as mentioned previously. Accessing it, using it, modifying and sharing. So that's a different definition. So what kinds of open content is there? I found this photo. Open knowledge, open education, open health. Not everything of that is open content in that sense. But I really like that since it got broader quickly. So here's an example. If you're translating a text in a blog, you found it, you're recording it and sharing it via social media. So normally you would need to talk to multiple lawyers to get the contracts to do all of that. But in order to make this possible with all this overhead, open content exists. It's just a constructed example, but open content should allow that. A chain of licenses, as is the case with normal business, wouldn't be possible without open content in a harder way, since open content allows that easily. For example, without these rules about open content, Wikipedia wouldn't be imaginable. For example, every time you look up on Wikipedia, you're now able to remember that it's just possible because of these open media rules, open content rules. So what tools are there for me to use? So there's CC licenses, that's one tool. There are multiple ones. The main principle is that I'm allowing everyone, not limited to area or time before publishing the work. So there can be many restrictions, like mentioning the original creator. So there are some exceptions you can add, but that's a general idea. So that was a general right, now I'm coming to more specific rights. It's pretty simple, but I'm just mentioning it to explain the principle. So there are multiple licenses, for example, data licenses, for example, one by the government of Germany, which wasn't very successful, but that's all right. So what is Creative Commons? It's an organization that thought of all these things. It's not an alternate copyright, that as it is the main idea often. It's just some things set up on the base of copyright law. These are differentiated license contracts that can be accessible to anyone without making everybody read the small print every time. So these are all of them with different restrictions, just the top two, calling names and sharing alike, count as open content. All the others are too restrictive to count as open content. So what are the modules? Every single license contains the mentioning module, which means that the original creator needs to be named, because that's the sort of currency with creative works. So that's what the reputation depends on. It's not about the money, it's about calling the name. So you need to call the name every time, say which license it is, name the title of the work, and as long as possible, add links and sources to find out where it was originally published. So how does this need to happen? It always depends on the media. So for example, in a film, it can be in the rolling on the end. In books, it can be at the image sources list. In the main, as long as it's able to be found easily. So the other thing for open content, the other module is share alike. It allows the publication of of modifications of the original work, which you need to still publish under the same license. So this is supposed to affect that you can not take works as your own once you're editing them. Most of Wikimedia projects have this condition. It's to make sure things stay free. There's another module called non-commercial, which means you're not open content anymore. It would mean that you're not allowed to use it commercially, but if you do, you need to ask me. It's not allowed for open content because that's a gray area most of the time. The open content effect is lost by that because it can often be a troublesome legal situation.
Well, the differences between these topics are very fluid. For example, with a YouTube video, that's if you use it in another video and a sample, for example, a sample of that, then that could be also viewed as a commercial application, and so non-copyright licenses would inflict that. This is a brochure that we've done once. We talked about the problematics of this in that brochure. The last module is no editing. You can basically figure out what this means by yourself. This is also called no derivatives. So what does no editing mean? Well, an editing is always occurs when it gets transformed, when it gets translated, when it gets rearranged, whatever. Because, for example, editing a photo or cutting a photo into other sizes, then it's also an infringement of that rule. So this isn't even open copyright usable. For all of these modules, you always have to state the original creator. You should always consider, you should always only constrict yourself to regulations you can enforce yourself to. You cannot say, if you publish something that's going to be big, don't say, you have to ask me every time, as you cannot do that yourself. So, how is this used? How much time do I have left? 5 minutes? 7 minutes? He was just informed. With CC licenses, there is a speciality. There are multiple different ways of showing this. There is a human readable, a machine readable, and a jurisdictionally readable version. So there's a document for this, and this is one standard that you would have had to read once, as this is just basic. And this is the RDFA version of this license. So this is basically for browsers or for scripts, so that they can filter through these license types as well. How does licensing this work? There are these texts which I just showed. You basically publish this. You write another article underneath it and say it should be published with that license. And so immediately when you read this document and immediately when you read that sentence, you basically are in a contract with the publisher to stick to these rules. So only when this allowance is needed does this apply. So if you're allowed to use this as citation, then these CC licenses, these Creative Commons licenses, aren't even necessary. So what if I change my mind? I made a CC license which I can't really do, which I can't really fulfill, which I don't really want to fulfill, I would really just want to publish this, for example, under a music licensor or under a music publisher who wants full license to this. So these aren't, you can't redact these licensings. So everyone who has already read this can use this, continue on using this. As soon as someone read this, as soon as someone saw this, this is really not reversible anymore. You can't, as soon as you published something under Creative Commons, you can't give someone exclusive rights over anything. So this is kind of a one-way lane in most cases. You can also remove these license things. That's all possible, but people can continue on using this. Just because you changed your website doesn't mean that these people can't continue on using it. Wikipedia does it in the same way. Wikipedia is also licensed under Creative Commons. They do this every time for every article. Usually you don't need this, so many people don't read it, but these license warnings are always very central and always very important. That's important because for the creator themselves, they go in contact with these people in that way. So if this gets lost, if this gets changed, then you have a jurisdictional problem. That's in that case, it's very bad because these editions are very bad to lose, because if you do these, if you just do some little mistake that doesn't allow this this usage, then you have a problem. So in Germany there's this license generator which automatically generates licenses for your uploaded pictures. For example, you can upload the URL of that picture and it will immediately spit out a license disclaimer. So there are three different stages of this. Every right is an no rights are applied to the user. Some rights are applied to the user, and every right is applied to the user. These public domain dedications are done under ODC0 or CC0. This, for example, says do anything you want with this, but don't complain to me about anything. I don't want to hear this. You can do this as well with other licensing methods, but with that you can basically exclude yourself from the process of replication. Then there's public domain. Then there's a tool that aims at making this more accessible. That's public domain mark. This is a reminder of the differences. These licenses change the legislation, and then the other ones don't. We already had this before, so I believe I have finished in time. Thank you very much. If you have questions, you can ask them.
Yeah, genau. Also erstmal einen herzlichen Dank, gab ich einen Applaus für den Vortrag und gibt's jetzt Fragen?
Thanks and a hearty applause for the speaker. Are there any questions?
Hello, Sascha ist mein Name.
Hello, I'm Sascha. I'd like to ask, with the CC0 license, does that exist in Germany in this form?
Wikipedia nach oder Wikipedia nachbauen würde, nochmal neu starten und dann CC0 überhaupt rechtlich legal.
If you rebuilt Wikipedia, could you do that legally?
In Germany, CC0 has kind of a problematic situation where in Germany there's a very restricted creator licensing situation. You can't really leave these ownership and this licensing out, as by law you always have some some rights over this. This doesn't work with German law enforcement. You can't just say no, I don't have any rights anymore. There's another thing. There's something else, which is basically just a CC0 license or another CC license without any clauses. It has a very similar effect. It just is a legislating matter. You can't really use CC0 in Germany, not 100% fully, but probably to like 98%.
Thanks for the talk. My question is, you said in Germany you can't give up all your rights, so it's not possible that I publish something even without rights and then someone else cannot claim it under their own license.
So licenses can only be given to people by people who have the rights. You can't really apply a CC license to anything you haven't done. If someone else takes your picture and applies a CC license to it, that doesn't work.
I've got a point on the question regarding the public and non-public assembly. How is it defined if you know someone or not? How close does this contact have to be?
That's a bit of a gray zone. Known doesn't have to mean related. Related is a trusted or known person. In that instance, friends are also where it gets really difficult are like classes in university or classes in school, where everyone knows the professor, but not the professor knows not doesn't know anyone everyone else. Most of this will be acknowledged in legislation. You also have the problem that people can just simply walk into presentations where you can't quite be sure that everyone knows each other. And in most university classes, that would be non-public, as anyone knows themselves, knows the other one in some relation or another.
Thanks for the talk.
Irgendwo zum Beispiel auf einer Common-Seite von der Wikimedia ein Foto, das ich gern auf Facebook posten würde.
Now imagine I find a photo on Wikipedia that I would like to use on Facebook. It is posted under a Creative Commons by and share alike. Now Wikimedia Commons does have other restrictions on images that are posted there. Could I use it on Facebook?
So Facebook has their own user-specific clauses where they guarantee that you have all the rights and you can use this picture however you want. That is the legislation between you and Facebook. It could be that Facebook will sue you at some point, or that Facebook gets sued because there's a picture on there which shouldn't be there, and then Facebook will come directly towards you. Between Facebook, a Facebook user, and the Facebook corporation, that isn't really a big appliance. If you take a picture from Wikipedia and publish it on Facebook, then it might be removed by Facebook's auto-removal system because of copyright laws. Because it could be that you might get sued from the creator as you made it be saved on these Facebook servers, and he might go towards you and say, hey, you've enabled usage for commercial services. So that might create some problems, but because these social media systems aren't really made to carry over these CC licensing additions. If you take pictures with CC Commons, then you can add these CC licenses to the picture and attach them to the actual JPEG or PNG, whatever, then that should be safe.
Sadly, this is going to be the last question, because there's going to be another talk after this.
Na gut, gibt's dann noch für jetzt gleich eine Frage?
Da war noch ein.
Direkt daran anschließend, du hast gesagt, man kann
directly on that,
Creative Commons Lizenzangabe in die Grafik einbauen.
You said you could put those CC licenses into the graphic itself. If the picture is non-derivative, if the license is non-derivative, I can't do that, right? What do I do then?
If the rest of the graphic stays the same and it doesn't change and you just add it below the picture, then that shouldn't change anything just because someone's attached below it. Basically, no one can say my picture got changed if someone attaches something else beneath it. So no one really does that. It's not really common practice.
Once again, hearty applause for the speaker and thanks for listening to the English translation.
Thank you.